President Trump's first public comment since Russia expelled hundreds of American diplomats is drawing some criticism. He did not condemn the move by Vladimir Putin. In fact, he did just the opposite.
No, I want to thank him because we're trying to cut down on payroll. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm very thankful that he let go of a large number of people because now we have a smaller payroll. There's no real reason for them to go back. So I greatly appreciate the fact that they've been able to cut our payroll for the United States. We'll save a lot of money.
We want to discuss this now with CNN Politics reporter and editor-at-large Chris Ciliza, CNN political analyst John Avlon, and CNN counterterrorism analyst Phil Mudd.
Can we just look at their faces again on the intros? There was no attempt to maintain any type of decorum.
No.
And he says, Phil, in there, he says there's no reason for them to go back. I mean, he's approaching this sort of as a CEO talking about job cuts by attrition, right? That's what he's saying, but that's not how this works.
There's a couple things you got to think about here. First, I don't understand the hypocrisy. The President of the United States with American friends keeps talking about reciprocity, particularly on trade. If we want to trade fairly, you give us something, we give you something. In this case, in terms of reciprocity, the United States tossed a few dozen Russians. The Russians eliminate hundreds of jobs from the embassy, and the President of the United States says, nothing about reciprocity, that's great. There is one personal point that I think is very painful for American officials who have dealt with foreign policy. It is August 2017. There's a lot of diplomats coming home from Russia who've got to find a school for their kids next month. How about if the president says thank you for their service instead of denigrating the fact that they worked in Moscow? A little bit of thanks to the people who worked overseas for the American population, I think, would be appropriate instead of saying thanks to Vladimir Putin.
Question of style, or do you see something else at play?
I see something else at play. I mean, let's acknowledge the fact that this isn't how government budgeting works, right? You know, Vladimir Putin doesn't order people out of a country and the U.S. saves money. That's a misunderstanding of how basic budget works from the alleged CEO president. You know, Putin doesn't shrink your payroll, you do. Second thing and more important, find me one example where Donald Trump has not lost an opportunity to suck up to Vladimir Putin when asked a tough question. Even when conservative commentators have said, well, he's a killer. The best he'll do is, well, there are lots of killers. Are we so innocent? Every time he gets pressed on Vladimir Putin, who's one of the bad guys on the international stage and a leader of a hostile foreign power, Donald Trump, the president of the United States, finds a way to praise him or deflect blame. That is, at some point, what it is, to use one of Donald's phrases. That looks like what it is, someone who has a reason, a compunction, an impulse to never say anything that could be construed as a criticism of the leader of Russia.
You hate that phrase.
Well, I do. I'm not going to spend my time decrying it is what it is, because it is what it is. I think what you're seeing, I grew up watching boxing. And in boxing, if a guy gets hit with a real solid punch, a lot of times the reaction is to try to shake it, to like show, oh, it didn't hurt me, like punch him, oh, it didn't hurt me, I'm totally fine. I think that's what Trump was going for here, to like show Putin, like, no, oh, you did that. Like, I'm going to joke about it. I'm going to let it roll off my back. The point, however, that John and Phil make is, I mean, number one, you're talking about 700 plus lives affected by this. Number two, you can't joke about certain things. He has a tendency, does this a lot, he has a tendency to joke about things that are frankly not terribly funny. And you can never tell if he's joking or if he's not. Like, if you played that clip five times, I've watched it five times, I think he means it tongue-in-cheek and meant to say, like, you didn't hurt us.
But
Putin,
there's no reason to go back kind of makes you think maybe he wasn't joking, right? Well, I see no reason for
this. This is my whole thing. I mean, he lives in this constant state. This was like the entire campaign was, wait, does he mean that? I mean, that's literally the entire campaign was spent trying to puzzle out. He says these things that are purposely provocative, purposely controversial, but with enough wiggle room where he often would say, well, I'm just joking, I'm just kidding around. And you couldn't disprove it, but you also couldn't prove it. Well, I mean, he purposely lives in that space.
Yeah, look, that may be his style. You know, I'm a tough guy, I like to joke around, a little towel snapping. But if that, you know, if the boxing metaphor you say is true, then he would have the same attitude towards Mitch McConnell when there's an innocuous criticism at a town hall. But instead, we go on a three-day Twitter rant against the leader of his own party in Congress.
So let's play a little sound of that. This is the latest back and forth between the president and the Senate Majority Leader, who stands at the middle of getting everything done that the president wants to achieve. Here.
I'm very disappointed in Mitch. But if he gets these bills passed, I'll be very happy with him. I'll be the first to admit it. But honestly, repeal and replace of Obamacare should have taken place. And it should have been on my desk virtually the first week that I was there or the first day that I was there. I've been hearing about it for 7 years.
Phil, look, Phil Mudd, get out. That would be an unreasonable expectation in terms of timing. But hold on. Because, Phil, on many points, you got to give the fair balance of criticism to what we're hearing from the panel, that whatever is done in the interest of style doesn't seem to be productive. However, here, I think most would suggest the president's got high ground. The Republicans had been promising to do this. This was a big part of the campaign. He did also go heavy on it, the president himself as a candidate, and McConnell hasn't delivered. So he has high ground. It winds up being, how does he deal with this relationship? What do you make of this back and forth?
No, I think you're right. He has half high ground, though. At some point when you're
half
president,
high ground?
Half high
how
ground.
How do you have half high ground, Phil Mudd?
Look,
I don't like vacillators.
The middle ground.
Don't vacillate on me, Mudd. That's not who you are.
Look, I understand you took your ugly pills this morning. I recommend stepping back.
Ouch. Why do you laugh?
But that was funny.
I wasn't laughing.
You're
I was
on
totally
my side.
It is what it is, Chris.
Oh. Go ahead,
it
Phil.
It is what it is, and you're hideous. Okay, so.
No.
That was
so.
A step
no,
too
look,
far.
I think there's something critically important. I don't think the issue here is repeal. I think the issue is replace. That is, if the Republicans had something to offer people like me, I have the Affordable Care Act, and my provider just said they're not signing up on January 1st. So I watch this with some personal interest. The president's right to critique Mitch McConnell, but the president did receive the bid from the Republicans last summer. He's been in office since January. My question would be, where is the conversation over the past year about a sophisticated replace plan so Americans and the Congress would say, we're okay with repeal because we know what happens afterward. At some point, you got to own it. And a year after winning the nomination, I think you have enough time to come up with a reasonable replace plan. I haven't seen it.
And also, to that point, Phil makes a good point. Yesterday, we had Senator Ron Johnson on here, one of the first Republicans I've heard. I don't know. You guys tell me if I'm wrong, where he said, all right, maybe repeal and replace. It didn't work. We've got to leave that alone. Let's find what's wrong and fix it. He came on. You can look online. You can see a lot of his economic reckoning. So maybe that's starting to go in the right direction. But, you know, appreciate that, guys. And thanks for stepping up, Brianna. Real Sorry. Nice of you.
But they share responsibility, right? That's what happens. The president shares some of the responsibility. That's just how it goes.
Yeah, that's how it goes.
All right.
Please.
Well, riveting testimony. I mean, it really is really, really fascinating from pop superstar Taylor Swift, if you've been following this, Chris, as I know you have closely, about the Denver DJ who allegedly groped her, what she told the judge next on New Day.